God is not an architect of universes, is not an architect of any structuring at all. And we get this directly from Jesus in Journey Beyond Words, transcribed by Dr. Brent Haskell. And for those who say, well, Doc, this is just Dr. Brent Haskell's words, he just, this came, all came from him. There isn't anybody on the face of this earth who could bring through such clarity and adamant teaching that is so amazing. This teaching is direct from Jesus. And just to say God is not an architect of universes, God does not produce any structure whatsoever, gives rise to the question, well, what is the structure, all the structure then? And Jesus' answer is again astonishing. There is no structure. The question is really a statement. This structure, what is it? It's saying there's structure. There is no structure, actually. This is something that the great Dzogchen Master Longchenpa also points out. So what is this then? It's an illusion of structure, for sure. Why? Because spirit, which is what we are, which is an extension of God, actually, with free will, freedom, absolute freedom. Spirit is trying to change what it is. It's trying to change what it is. So this dream of structure is spirit's attempt to change what it is, to alter the nature of reality, the nature of God, the nature of spirit. But it is just a dream. It is just a dream. There's no real structure at all. Now, this is obviously a teaching of a higher caliber. And so it's a wow teaching. And you come across this, and it's for sure you're going to say, wow. Absolutely. And getting used to this is quite an odyssey, actually. Because of our continuity fear, we say, wow, if I accept this, I will see the absolute innocence of reality, the total innocence of reality. No sin, no guilt, no need for atonement whatsoever. And in seeing, in glimpsing this absolute innocence of reality, we're just struck with anguish, like, how could we ever turn away from that? How could we ever believe that any of this was true, that we've been dreaming? The dream just seems to be utter garbage. You know, utter garbage. And we get the continuity fear. So, whoa, wait a minute. I put a lot of effort into this. I really believed in this for so long. And so it's a double shock. We're shocked by the complete immaculate purity that I am, and of I am, that is all. And we're shocked by that absolute purity and innocence. We're shocked that we could ever try to turn our back on that. We're shocked by all this grotesqueness of the dream. You know, so it's just, there's this complex of just like, whoa, I just gotta back off of that and imagine there's some God that is causing all of this dream. And then pray to this God, please God, keep it going, keep it going, keep it going, keep it going. You know, so we offer sacrifice to this God, and praying that it keeps continuing. When in fact, we're the ones who are imagining this. It's all within us. We're the ones. So we don't want to be. We don't want to recognize this fact because that means we could stop it. So what we do is we believe that it's coming from some source other than us, which we call a God, and then pray to that God to keep it going, keep it going, keep it going. This is what we've been doing. So we invent all these belief systems, you know, all these worship types of worship and everything to keep it going. and we're terrified. This, if we don't, the anger of this God might not keep it going. You know, this, it just shows how frightened we are. So the fact is, we don't like this dream. And so we project this onto this imaginary God and say, this God is really angry at us and is going to stop this dream if we don't keep saying, hey, God, we really want it. We love it. You know, look how wonderful it is. Here, let me give you my favorite, best calf. You know, let me give you this sacrifice. Here, let me, here, take this. You know, I want you to be pleased. I want you to be pleased. Madness, right? You look at history, it's just absolute madness. Born of this tremendous continuity issue, okay, which throughout history has gone unacknowledged for the most part, unacknowledged, and that's why the madness has just continued to continue to continue. God is pure love, has no preference whatsoever for anything arising or not arising. Absolute, pure spaciousness. There's no preference whatsoever. God is not an architect of universes. God is not trying to fashion the way we think of worlds. God doesn't have preferences at all. Absolute freedom, absolute freedom. So, we're trying to deal with our dismay, with our anguish, and our fear. Like, oh my gosh, how can we make this garbage dump better so we don't have to face the absolute purity of what is, and this anguish? How can we avoid? We're afraid of setting this down. We see how perfect reality is. We don't want anything to do with this world. We forget it like instantly. And I said, oh my gosh, I can't just forget all this, you know? So we try to make it better, more attractive, so we stay more interested in it and don't look at reality, actually, the nature of reality, instead we keep our attention on the dream. And we pray to some power, we call it God, some dynamic. We say, I hope there's some dynamic that keeps our attention on this dream and, we can rely upon that. And yet, our attention keeps shifting off of it. We think, wow, God, God's so difficult to please. You know, how come God's not keeping our attention on the dream? We imagine there's this force that's keeping our attention on this dream, other than our own will, you see. So we insist, oh, God, there must be a God that keeps our attention on this dream and tells us how to be good stewards of the dream, how to increase the beauty of this dream, and all this imaginary structure, imaginary process, imaginary form. Imaginary space, time, space, it's all imaginary. But we cling to it out of desperation. Coming to this world is really quite something. You come into this world and you think everybody here is completely mad. And that madness, screaming at you and you feel oppressed by it. You come into this world from higher realms, so to speak, less continuity, fear involved, and you say, what are these people talking about here? What are they praying to this God to keep them focused on this world? Or what in the world is that? You know, it's just bizarre, absolutely bizarre. I think at best we can say this world and the history of this world is absolutely bizarre. That's the best you can say about it. And continues to be, if not getting worse. the fear is so extreme, you're just trying to get truth in here. It gets put into the wrong context. So anyway, we can speak of this here. Funny thing, even though this world is just absolutely garbage dump, we're desperate to hold on to it and at least put some tinsel on the garbage dump. Because, again, not Your fear of something terrible. Fear of something perfect. Fulfill a fear of perfection. Perfection just seems too much for us. Too much. And so it's either perfection or this world, basically. That's what we think. Now, fortunately, God has given us an intermediate step called supernature. So, the whole dynamic of worshiping a God who supposedly keeps our attention on nature, that has to be seen for what it is. And we see that for what it is by realizing the one and only true God, which is totally impersonal, totally without preferences, total freedom, total love, absolute clear light, the form of everything. This God does recognize that continuity issue here. And so this God, not from a sense of preferences, okay, but from a standpoint of pragmatism. We have a problem. How is this problem solved? Supernature. That too is merely an appearance. There's no real structure there either. But it's like I say, it's nature that seems to be devoid of nature. Continuation of this bloodline is a continuation of nature. Okay, it's very important. Now, what Jesus did is he shed his blood. In other words, he gave up his blood of his body, let it be spilled upon the ground, as it were. So he didn't continue it. And he showed us, I have no desire, I have no need to continue nature at all. No need whatsoever. And the body without the blood, resurrected body, blood's already been shed. What does that mean? Supernature. Supernature. Supernature doesn't have the blood in it, so to speak. Okay. Doesn't have the blood in it. Doesn't have the reproduction. No reproduction is taking place there. No chemistry. No biology. None of that, you see. Doesn't have the blood. So when you start tying this together, you start to get a little bit of sanity. It's incredibly difficult. I've spent my whole life on working on all this. But anyway, here we are, getting some sanity. So Jesus, 33, super healthy, perfectly healthy, and no bloodlines, no marriage, no children, no bloodlines. He was willing to lay his bloodline down and say, I don't need it. I'm not interested in bloodlines. I'm not interested in nature, in other words. Nature has no value for me. So what he showed us, the world, us here, is that we need not value nature at all, actually. And you think, uh-oh, you know, wow, that means that we have to go back to accept our perfection, formless perfection. And Jesus, the resurrection, said no. No, they're supernature. They're supernature. It's an intermediate step. The death-free realms. The death-free realms. Which still have this nominal form of nature. But there's no processes as we see all this stuff. The blood is not flowing. The nature-free nature. Nature free of nature, as it were. This is a very, very key. This enables us then to experience what we would say is natural perfection before we even set that down and realize the absolute perfection, which doesn't need any witnessing to it, you know. So first we experience natural perfection. That's the intermediate step. Instead, what we have been doing is trying to make this world of nature so nice that we don't want to even, you know, look to our perfection. That's not going to work. This world of nature, this world that we see here, is in no way reminds us of reality. Other than, you know, just the faintest, the faintest, the faintest, the faintest, the faintest echoes. Which isn't enough to deal with the continuity fear we have. It's not enough. So it's futile to toil in this world to try to make it better. Jesus didn't try to make this world better. The great sages have not tried to make this world better at all. They said that's absolute folly. Ramana Maharshi pointed this out by saying, you know, put on a pair of shoes instead of trying to get rid of all the pebbles and stickers and, you know, thorns and everything on the footpath of this world, and walk around barefoot and try to perfect this world. He said, that's not the way. Just put on a pair of shoes, meaning supernature. Just be aware of supernature, and this will dispel the grief of nature and how awful it is, and we'll say, wow, this is really wonderful. It's like perfect nature. And then from there it's easy to say, wow, I don't even need any specific appearance at all. All appearances are perfect. Everything is perfect, actually. There's only perfection. But that's a huge leap. From where we are now to that, that's such a huge leap. We have a continuity issue about it. So, of course, everybody was saying, Jesus, you know, here you are, you're the Messiah. You're here to establish a worldly kingdom which will, you know, have all these slaves who are not high up in the hierarchy of this kingdom with their brooms sweeping all the pathways of this world, so the higher ups can walk around in bare feet and feel like, wow, this world is really great. I don't need to look at my true nature at all. And Jesus said, no, that's not it. I'm not going to establish any bloodlines whatsoever. The mistaken belief that Jesus came here to establish some sort of secret bloodlines is truly a most erroneous, dualistic, delusional belief. Just the opposite. He came here to say, look, I have no attachment to nature whatsoever, and neither do you need to have any attachment. I'm going to my Father's kingdom, but look, instead of appearing as just clear light, he appeared as a resurrected body, saying, resurrected nature, in other words, pure nature, pure perfect nature, is an intermediate step back to the absolute formlessness of I amness, the isness of God. The zero preference nature of God, which we cannot understand at this point, really. We can experience it directly, but we really cannot put it into terms of nature at all. It cannot be put into this context of nature, no way. But it can be sort of put into the context of supernature. And then you feel like, hey, I don't even need to put it into any context. Supernature speaks volumes of just inherently about it. And you realize, oh, I don't have to put it into this context even. And you know, so it's a wonderful, you know, wonderful intermediate step. trying to put reality into the context of this dream of nature, which is an attempt to change reality. Forget it. Forget it. Don't even try. Doesn't need to be. Doesn't, because of supernature, we don't need to put it into context of nature. We don't need to. It's too difficult. It results in all sorts of bizarre rituals, in, you know, purification rituals, and it just, you know, it freaks us out. We can't do it. Just like this moth is freaking out, you're flying all over the place. So we don't need to struggle with determinancy, with the perfection of supernature, which is the absence of all the supposed processes. There's no blood, no processes there. There's no genetics, there's no DNA. Supernature has no DNA, it has no genetics. There's no reproduction, no biology, no chemistry. Not even normal physics that we understand, but everything does seem to be following. Just, you know, it's, the ground doesn't, you know, trees just don't float necessarily, but things seem to have some sort of order to them. Yes, but very much of what we think of as nature, there's no dust, there's no disintegration, for instance. There's no aging, there's no growing. There's no disease. All of this, see, is an absence of what we think of as nature. And that inherent automatic absence of all this, then we say, wow, this is easy. It's easy now to get a feel for reality. Very easy. Don't have to say anything. I can feel it. So it's the context that enables us, this context of nature here, just drives us all bonkers, actually, trying to get some sort of sense of explaining some reality, you know. Wow. So the practice is just to abide in indeterminacy. Give up this effort to explain. Don't need to. Those who are not aware or deny supernature, they feel they have to somehow explain, have to tell this world, you know, about it or something. No, don't have to explain. Just give the basics of supernature is the intermediate step. Now, certainly, for instance, if the body passes away, and your attention goes to the supernatural realm, the true supernatural realm, death-free realm, process-free realm. You don't have to, your attention will not get pulled back into this dream of nature, won't get pulled back into it. But most who their body passes away, their attention is still on process. It's just in the afterlife, there's all this process also. So that process inevitably pulls the attention back into this more, quote unquote, gross process we call nature. And here you are again. And what a bummer. You know, it's like, wow. I thought, well. So it's not the death of the body that frees you automatically, frees your attention to supernature. No, it's the practice. And actually, this world's a good place to practice. In the afterlife, there seems to be, attention gets easily pulled into all sorts of stuff, and you may not practice at all. I don't, you know, that's a possibility. But here, you can feel just how awful it is, and how awful nature is, and can decide, hey, I'm gonna practice indeterminacy, absolute indeterminacy. The maybe-ness, I don't know-ness. See, in supernature, there's nothing to know about process. There's nothing to know about science whatsoever. There's nothing to know at all. You don't have to have knowledge, so to speak, right, of nature, no, not needed in the slightest bit. That's why I have no interest in science or knowledge about this world, really. Doesn't matter. What does a dream matter? What kind of knowledge can you have about a dream? Nothing's really happening. We're not changing what we are. We're not changing reality. So there's nothing that's happening. The fact that everything here is being changed, perpetually changes, is supposedly trying to convince us that reality is being changed. It's not being changed at all. So this is just, you know, as they say, this nature is actually empty. It's not, nothing is, there's nothing that's really happening. Just the constant change of appearance. It's all just one appearance. Just one vast, nature's just one vast appearance. Like a vast kaleidoscope, and it's just slowly changing. You know. Buddhists say everything is devoid of any self nature. You know, they point this out too, of this. So there's nothing that needs to be known. There's nothing really that needs to be known. The fact that we're trying to be influenced by this doesn't mean that we are. The fact that we have our attention on this doesn't mean our attention has been harmed in any way, actually. We're pretending it has been harmed, but pretending it somehow it's lost its capability. It hasn't. It hasn't. We're just pretending that it has. So we can shift our attention onto supernature. Just like I saw my cat in a dream, the cat was in flawless condition, absolutely flawless condition. It's possible there was no blood, no, you know, DNA, no processes at all. It was just like a pure appearance, just a pure appearance, like a holographic appearance. But this dream has been crafted with all our creativity. So it seems it's difficult to accept that it's just a dream, for sure. Seems very realistic, you know. We've really done a great job, you know, deceiving ourselves. So, of course, most of us throughout history have been supremely deceived by it all. But there are those who have not been deceived by it, and they share their understanding with us, and we, in some way, take it on faith, and also, having glimpses of reality, we realize, wow, this really is a dream. It's just really difficult to see, to recognize this, and we just say, well, let's not struggle with it. We don't really have to recognize it that way, per se. We can simply shift our attention to supernature. So who is behind supernature? The Holy Spirit is. The Holy Spirit is. So you see, this is the Trinity. This is important. The Trinity is important. God the Father, which was just the prime creator, that which extended itself as God the Son. Okay. Now, God the Son has a continuity problem. It needs an intermediate step. So how does that happen? God the Son extends itself in a way which we call God the Holy Spirit. is actually God the Holy Spirit that is the one that is sustaining supernature, that is holding this desire as a moth here. That's holding this desire of supernature for us, moment by moment. And the Holy Spirit is absolutely pure, as we every all is. It has no continuity problem at all. So it effortlessly holds supernature in place for us, moment by moment. So we need not be concerned that we might offend the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will take supernature away from us. We need not develop rituals praying to the Holy Spirit, please don't take supernature away from us, like we've been doing here with nature, praying, you know, imagining that there's a God. Or it used to be that, you know, the whole thing about monotheism is basically, like for instance in Roman times, there were so many gods, and everything had like a soul, a divine principle that needed to be prayed to and placated, every bit of nature. And so the Roman Empire was saturated with gods and goddesses. And their lives, you know, it's just like, wow, it's just the whole thing was ritual. I need to appease this god, appease this god, appease everywhere they went, you know. The idea, and the whole ancient world has so many, many, many gods and goddesses, thinking that everything had this, some way you could pray to this and it would sustain itself for you, because they were afraid that nature will not sustain itself, which just comes from a deep knowing that we're the ones who are imagining this like a dream, and we can stop dreaming at any time we want to, any moment. There is no determinacy about this dream, about anything in reality. Reality is completely indeterminate, meaning one moment does not determine the next. So we keep thinking if we sacrifice and pray to these imaginary deities, nature deities, that they will sustain it for us. Now what monotheism does, what it does is saying, you know what, we have a more, even more effective way of sustaining the dream, because all these different deities, we might anger them, you know, and forget some, and then they might stop. So he said, let's just say that there's just one God that is sustaining all of this, and then put all our effort and energy into praying to this God. And if we just please this God, then God will sustain all of this nature for us. Whereas if we have, you know, thousands and thousands and millions of deities everywhere, how can we possibly placate all of them and convince them to keep on sustaining this, you know, nature for us? So we just, you know, out of fear, we said, what's the best way to deal with our fear? Oh, let's have just one God, pray to this God. This God will sustain nature for us. And it's easier that way, safer. So if you have, you know, monotheism, as opposed to polytheism, the ancient world was very polytheistic. And then the idea says, wait a minute, maybe if we just consolidate all this into one God, then we'll be even safer. Better, you know, it's a safer way to go, we imagine, right? So that's the origin of monotheism, and then we consider that a great advancement, you know. But the true God is, there's nothing you can say. It's not monotheistic, it's not polytheistic, it has no preference at all. It's just pure love, pure freedom. There is only that. You can't say it's a monotheistic or polytheistic, and you can't say anything about it. It's just omnipresent, totally supportive, without any judgment whatsoever. There's no locus, no center to it. There's no structure to God at all. None. Zero dimensional. That's why the term zero dimensional applies. No structure at all. So how can you say it's one or it's many or is it no? Are the only God? Then those words don't have any meaning really. And are desire to apply words to God is actually this fear of wanting to speak to God and say, hey, God, can you please sustain nature? What do we need to do? You know, I don't want to sin against you. If I sin against you, you might stop it all, you know? And so we think we need words. We don't need words. That's why they say God is experienced in silence. But then when we come back from the silence, everyone wants to know, you reach God. Well, what did God say about how to please God? Do they want words? Well, they want the communication. Well, there's no communication from God as far as words go. There's just the isness of it. There's the pure isness of it. So, there you have it. And we get worried. We think, oh, wow, I reach God and I can help everybody because everybody here in this world is so desperate. But understand, they're desperate to find out what kind of incantations and prayers they can give to this imaginary God of nature that will sustain nature for them. And there is so they want, you know, that kind of communication, which is, you cannot get that from God at all. You cannot take anything from God, take anything away from, you know, and bring it here, so to speak. You can bring it to this nation. You cannot. There's nothing to take. You can just abide in God is all you can do, actually. You cannot be fragmented. So God is not someone we can go to and talk to and say, hey, God, how do we sustain nature here? You know, you're doing a great job, but we want to make sure you keep on doing it. So gradually we're getting it here. Gradually we're getting it. This is very slow, isn't it? But at the same hand, it's better late than never. Better slow than not at all. You might say, what did God say? God was absolutely silent. Well, didn't you talk with God? There's nothing to say. It's absolutely silent. Doesn't matter what you say. It's absolutely silent. Well, what are God's preferences? No preferences. And they say, well, how can we please God then? We don't know what God's preferences are. I mean, does God like this type of incense or that type of prayer, these type of bells? I mean, what can we do to communicate with God through the incense and the bells and the rituals and let God know that we're really pleased that God is sustaining nature for us, you know, and please make it better, God, so we, you know, aren't tempted to realize that we're behind it all. And no, there's nothing to please God. There's God doesn't need to be pleased. So, what I'm saying is there's this pressure that's put on anyone who is in the presence of God to, you know, bring back this information to help people worship this imaginary God of nature. There's all this pressure it's about to bear. This is so bizarre about this world. And this has to be recognized. And most people, you know, are clueless. They say, well, you didn't really see God then because God would have told you, you know, how God wants to be worshipped. You know, so that this is the problem. This is part of what trips us up, is the demands that we feel placed upon us. And we think, well, I got to. So there's nothing we need to understand. It's a felt experience of, wow, God's everywhere. This is the nature of reality. How awesome is that? There's no need to propitiate God whatsoever. No need to incantate. No need for rituals. No need for any approach to God. No need for any of that. Well, none of it's necessary. And this is just a pure, you know, God is just this absolute, omnipresent purity of isness, zero preference. And so everything is already all perfectly aligned with God. There's no need for any worship or rituals or approach or propitiation at all from anything, anywhere, whatsoever. Everything's already on perfect terms with God, and there's no way it could ever be otherwise. This is the realization. And of course, for dualistic nature worshippers, they're terrified. They want a monotheistic nature God that they can pray to and propitiate and think that they're, you know, giving to God so God gives back to them, that this, hey God, I'll give you all the bounty of nature and I'll work hard and you sustain it for me, sustain it. So, you know, that misses God altogether. And so how do you reach them? Message doesn't get through there. Everything is already in perfect harmony. No way it could not be. There isn't anything to say about how do I get on the good side of God. There are no sides to God at all. But in our fear, we think, well, there must be the side of God deciding, doesn't want to sustain nature. No, that's us. That's spirit. That's us trying to change what we are. And sure, we will decide, oh, I don't want this appearance anymore. It doesn't do anything anyway. But God is supporting whether we want this dream or not. It's all the same to God. So seeing God means you see all is on perfect terms with God, inherently so, can never be otherwise. It's impossible that anyone could ever be ostracized. It's impossible that anyone could need to get in alignment with God. It's impossible that anyone needs to say prayers or rituals to get on the good side of God. It's all that is totally, absurdly impossible. Not in play whatsoever. Never will be. No one can ever be excluded. No one can ever get on the bad side of God. There is no bad side of God to get on. No one can be out of sorts with God. It's impossible. Everyone is already a perfect savior. Even beyond that, actually. All is already perfect. In perfect harmony with God. All is always in perfect harmony with God. This is the realization. And without anything being done whatsoever, or not being done. So this is the non-dual message. This is the message of truth. This is the message that really saves us from this madness that we've been involved with. So we don't require a personified anthropomorphic God figure, you see. God is this sheer absence of appearance, of form. The form of all appearance. Right here, right now, the form of all form, which is the sheer absence of any particular form whatsoever. People want to believe they can talk to God like it's a human form or something, you know. and they get their message through. So they think they're getting the message through. Hey, God, I really, really want you. I really love what you're doing here with nature. Can you keep it going? You know, they want that. There is no such God like that. So we keep on with our idolatry, which is just really self-worship, where we're just projecting. Out of our fear, we project this notion of that there's some, you know, form-based God that we can request favors of and figure out how to do business with and kind of deal, that kind of stuff. There's no deals that need to be made. You see, there's no deals that need to be made reality. There's no deals possible. Everything is already perfect. Inherently so, can never stray from that whatsoever. So the idea of deals is non-existent, totally non-existent. So at least we can listen to this non-dual talk, so we can still use words and clarify this. And so, you know, that's what we can do. And we understand that all this other stuff is just continuity fear. And we're able to speak in this non-dual way because we've evaporated a lot of the continuity fear. It just takes a lot of work, a lot of effort, a lot of patience. Full stop in the now, full stop in indeterminacy. No answers for anything. No questions for anything. No answers, no questions. No teaching, no teacher, no student. Just practice that. And you'll have a great time at it. It's like, wow, it's the greatest thing ever. It's the most intense, amazing situation you ever will have. The spiritual path is incredible. Just, wow, I don't have to give any answers. I don't have to have any questions. You can just be completely indeterminate and just let your mind rest on that just a little bit, and that's a revelation. And then you realize right away, wow, I really am. This is I am. I mean, I don't have to do anything to be I am. And deep within you, you realize your freedom is still with you. It's just like, wow. You know, it's subtle, but it's there. And then you say, wow, this is beats anything. This is the ultimate spiritual path. It's really the ultimate in terms of any endeavor whatsoever. And then it leads to the realization that no endeavor is ever required of any appearance whatsoever. It's all inherently self-released in the now. So everything's inherently saturated with pure spaciousness. There's nothing that is not. It's just the way it is, inherent, the inherentness of reality. Totally self-evident, totally inherent. So just keep practicing this indeterminacy, full stop in the now, the wow, the burn, the indeterminacy, the complete indeterminacy, full stop in the indeterminacy. Don't determine questions, don't determine answers. Don't determine course of action or non-action. And just abide in this, abide in this, abide in this. And this gradually gets you, evaporates your fear, gradually evaporates your fear. It won't evaporate all at once. It'll gradually evaporate the fear. And so anyone can do this. Just full stop in the indeterminacy, full stop in the now, which is prior to any actions, any questions, any answers. It's immediate, the complete, full stop in pure immediacy. Anything that arises, we say, well, is that pure immediacy? Full stop in the absolute instant, full stop in the now, and just abide in that. Not striving to be perfect about it. Just drop the striving for either striving or non-striving. loosely like this, and this evaporates the continuity fear. So, and then you will find you're able to relate to this. You know, you're able to relate to non-dual talk. And you say, oh, I feel comfortable with that. Yeah. Then you say, wow, thank God I'm getting out of this nature God thing. Yeah, this horrible situation. Thank God I'm no, I don't feel bound by that anymore. What a relief, you know, I just keep working at it. So that's what we're doing here. And we'll continue to do so, and let the experience of God come as soon as possible. Absolutely. And the way that maybe that arises is that you simply say, let all experience God right now. Without anyone having to do anything whatsoever. Instantaneous for all. So all together, we all together experience God. Free everybody from all their rituals, all their questions, all their answers.